Australia's one of our friends that we're fighting the Japanese too. And the Japanese is a pretty big island. Japan is over near China. And their army and navy were coming, going from island to island down towards Australia. And they were getting so close that they were building an airstrip, you know, for airplanes to fly into on an island called Guadalcanal. That when they got that airplane, they could bomb, their big bombers could bomb Australia. And this would not be very good for, well, none of it was very good, but anyway, that would be a real bad threat to Australia. So the Americans and the Australians and everybody got together, and the Americans decided to capture the island of Guadalcanal before the Japanese finished the airstrip. So they won on August 7th, about 55 years ago. American Marines went in there. And they landed on Guadalcanal and a couple of other islands close by that the Japanese run also. And there wasn't much resistance to the landing on Guadalcanal because they were mostly workers building the airfield there. There were some soldiers there, but not as many, like Lagi, where the headquarters for the whole operation were. And one of the other islands called Florida Island. And it was just, I don't know how come it got named Florida, but anyway, it did. But I was in the Navy in the bunch, one of the guys that went on landed there, and the Navy shelled the island pretty strictly before it landed. There wasn't any particular resistance, at least for where we were. So we got set up there, and we had some skirmishes, and they landed. The Japanese were very upset that we took this island, and they decided they wanted to take it back, so they started landing troops on either end of the island. And oh, they came down with their navy real fast and chased our navy away because they were so strong, and they had a big battle out there, and they sank some of our ships. We sank some of theirs too. But they,
you know what the navy is, Glenn?
Oh, warships, you know, big warships with cannons and stuff on them. They came in, you know, cannons. And we had some fights with these guys, and they decided they were going to have to send a lot more men than they down to do the job that they had, so they started up. I'm reading this book right here about the what they call them. They were the watcher. They were on the islands. They were guys that worked on the islands. The Beaver Brothers were one of those outfits, you know, raising the coconuts.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyway, they report. They would report all the kinds of action. They know the natives and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Before. Anyway, while they were trying to land their men there, we were trying to keep them out, and when they would land, they'd finally build up enough guys and they'd attack us, and we had a what they called a perimeter. We had a line of men all the way around the Air Force. They'd say this was the airport here, mm-hmm. and this big thing was the island here. Well, we had men going all the way around here. We kind of got all the guys in that we thought they needed. And we were, we were stationed at some of those places. And one time, we found out there were a bunch of guys that were Japanese down one end of the island, and they were they were, I don't know what kind of an outfit they were. They were medical outfit or what they were, but they, the idea was that they were sort of unprotected, so we were going to go down there and see if we could capture them or wipe them out, whatever. Depends on how much of a fight they put up.
And like the English and Japanese guys?
Japanese.
Yeah, Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
Japanese what? What were they?
He was just repeating what you're saying, basically.
Oh, yeah. So the Japanese were, yes, I see. Yeah. So they drove us down there in big trucks. Nobody bothered us going down. So we got the bus to where they thought it was, and they unloaded. And some reconnaissance guys were already down there. We've been watching them, I guess, for a couple of days. So we were supposed to sneak up on them and attack them and see if we could capture some of them or wipe them out or whatever. So, but they had a bunch of, we had to survive them because we didn't have enough extra guys that we could do this with a pitched battle. So we were sneaking up on them, and this one sentry was goofing off. The Japanese sentry was goofing off. He was leaning against the tree asleep, helmet pushed down over his head. So if we get by him, we could sneak up on the other guys and really give him a working over. But I was the guy that was in the front, was what they called the point.
What's the point?
The guy that goes first. I'd be the scout. Like
the scout.
Sort of like a scout.
Oh, and he's the guy who makes sure stuff clean and all that?
Yeah, then nobody, we're supposed to look up in the trees and make sure there aren't any snipers or any ambushes ready for us. Or that type of stuff. See, point things out. So, we didn't have an awful lot of real good equipment at that time because the war had just started and they hadn't had a lot of stuff. So what we had for a knife to stab this guy with, all we had was a mess knife, which you would use like a table knife. It came in our mess gear was called a cans and stuff that we ate for, called mess gear. And that's all we had. So we would, whoever would be the scout or whatever, would get that knife, he'd get to use it. And this guy was in such a position, the usual way to try to kill a guy with a knife is to pull his head back and put the knife up under his ribs into his heart. You had to pull it back real fast and get that fast to be real strong. But this guy was leaning forward and his helmet was down over his head. So what I did was come up behind him, like I should have anyway, and instead of reaching around like that, I just hit him in the back of the neck. And the foreman that was with us said that what I did was break his neck. Well, I hit him in the back of the neck with that thing, and I broke the knife. I got yelled at for that, but anyway, taking the equipment. Anyway, his head just fell forward, and he just dropped. And the foreman, that's the medical guy that we take with us to help us if we get wounded or something like that. But he said that I broke the guy's neck. So then he just dropped. So that was, I did a perfect job, but I didn't know I was doing a perfect job at the time. I was scared stiff.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, then so we could all go in. And we had all these automatic weapons. They had what we called a BAR, that's a Browning automatic rifle. And they just, it's like a machine gun. And you carry it, big long thing. And they used that, and we wiped the most of them out before, and they captured a couple of them here. Put them back in the trucks. So we went back. Is that a good adventure?